question is from Will Spence. I understand you say 9 to 18 sets per muscle group per week, but what do you define as a set when multiple muscles are working at once? For example, would 5 sets of regular bench press count as 5 sets of tricep work as the triceps are still working?
You know what? This is actually a good question. I remember thinking this myself as a youngster working out, and it is on the surface intuitive, right? I know that a pull-up is going to work. I know it's a back exercise, but my biceps are quite involved, so are my forearm muscles. Yep. I know that a squat is my hamstrings. Calves are somewhat involved. There's a lot of muscles involved with the deadlift, so this makes a lot of sense in terms of a question. But just to simplify, when we say 9 to 18 sets per muscle group, we're referring to exercises that are specifically designed to target, not just isolate, but just specifically designed for those body parts. So traditionally speaking, a bench press is a
chest
exercise.
Right.
Traditionally speaking, an overhead press is a shoulder exercise. When it comes to arms, it's basically the isolation movements that would be considered arm exercises, except for some of the compound ones.
Now, that being said, I think that's why the studies say things like 9 to 18. That's a huge range.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a huge range because somebody who does all a bunch of machine isolation exercises probably is going to have to be somewhere towards the 18 range to get the similar benefits as someone who's doing a lot of compound lifts can probably just do 9 of a lot of those exercises because they're doing those good lifts like squats and bench press and overhead press that are incorporating a lot of secondary muscles. Yeah. So I think that's where you see a range like that. I mean, if you're doing 9 sets and you're including the big lifts, I mean, at the end of the day, we thought through all of this when we programmed every program that we've done. So this is part of when you think of, you know, what you're paying for with a program for us is that, you know, we've taken into account what all the research says when we write it all out, like, okay, where's kind of that sweet spot for what for the majority of people going to land so they're getting the optimal amount. In fact, I had a guy message me today about combining MAPS anabolic with MAPS performance. And I was like, whoa, no.
Same guy messaged me.
Oh, did
Come
he?
Come on, guy. Yeah. We probably tell him the same thing, too.
Yeah, like, no, guy. No, not at all. What I did tell him, I said, you could, if let's say you love MAPS anabolic or you're following that, but you want to do more mobility work, I have told people, like, totally fine to take the trigger sessions out.
Swap them out.
Yeah, frequency builders are definitely something you can swap.
Right, and then swap it out for mobility instead of trigger sessions. But as far as, like, your foundational days, like, your heavy lifting and how we've programmed that, no, you're getting ample amount of volume, and it's scaled within all the programs, so there's no reason for you to try. You're not going to get more results by adding more or combining programs together.
No, you actually bring up a good point, though. Isolation exercises, your body has generally speaking, a higher capacity and resilience towards isolation-type movements than compound movements, and typically a higher resilience to machines over free weight exercises. So what does this mean for you? This means that if you want to do a lot of sets and you want to add a ton of volume, but you don't want to overtrain, then you can start to throw on those isolation movements because the compound ones tend to blast your body and your central nervous system a little bit more. In fact, studies actually show this. Studies show that going to failure, okay, this is where you lift a weight to the point where you can't lift it anymore with good form. So you literally lift until you fail for a set. It's like the top of intensity. I mean, you could push it past that, but that's just insane. And studies show that for the most part, is too much intensity for most people. But there is one caveat. Sometimes going to failure for isolation movements, totally fine. And it's because it doesn't hammer the body as much as these compound movements. So that is an important thing to note. When you look at your total workout, if you're designing your own workout, let's say you don't want to follow one of our programs, it's written for you, you want to kind of figure out your own thing. You're like, you know, I want to add 5 sets of volume to my chest workout. You might want to start with 5 extra sets of isolation type movements on top of what you've been doing just to kind of feel it out. Throwing 5 sets of compound movements might be too much. It might be too taxing. So it's totally true. You know, your body's ability to recover and handle and adapt to an exercise, there's a lot of things that contribute to that. Intensity is one of them. and then the kind of exercise. The exercises that tend to be the most taxing also tend to be the most effective.
Mm-hmm.
This is why, you know, exercises like deadlifts and squats and overhead presses just give you more bang for your buck.
Well, that's why I'm always kind of focused in that direction first. Like, how can I incorporate these compound lifts and the most effective exercises? Then I'll structure in, you know, more of those other like isolation type movements to then build up the volume around those lifts.
Yeah, yeah. When I go to the gym on my off days, if just like I'm bored and I'm like, I want to go to the gym and do some extra exercises, I do isolation and machine exercises because I know that that's my body can handle a little bit more, but not too much more. So I walk around, I use machines and isolation exercises, and I'll push up more towards the 18 sets per muscle group per week by doing it that way.